We will now study how to compute the partial derivative of the end effector vector. Here we see the definition of the partial derivative of the end effector, and we expand it into columns. Each column of the partial derivative is the end effector position differentiated with respect to the corresponding link angle. So first column is differentiation with respect to theta 0, second column would be theta 1, third column theta 2, and so on, so on, so. We immediately substitute in a homogeneous coordinate representation for the end effector. So we see here the multiplication of all the homogeneous coordinate transformation matrices differentiated with respect to theta j. We will now derive an approach for computing the jth column of the Jacobian matrix. First, we apply the product rule to all the products of transformation matrices and the tooltip vector. This expands into several terms. The first term will have the partial derivative applied to the first term in multiplication. The second term, the partial derivative will be applied to the second term, and so on and so. So we end up with an expansion having a sum of all these terms, where each term have a partial derivative with respect to a transformation matrix. First term would be zero transformation matrix with respect to theta j, and so on, so on, so. And the last term would be a partial derivative of a tooltip vector with respect to theta j. We immediately see this would go out as we assume that the tooltip vector is a constant, and a constant taking the derivative of that would be zero, so this term immediately goes away. But we wish now to know what happens with the remaining terms here. So you're gonna look at a general transformation matrix, the kth transformation matrix, and then we're gonna take the partial derivative of that matrix with respect to theta j. And we observe if k is different from j, then nothing in this transformation matrix would depend on theta j, hence everything would be zero. If j is equal to k, then we apply the partial derivative with respect to theta j to each of the individual terms in this matrix. We see this, 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 and this, and this would be zero, as they do not depend on theta j. And the rotation matrix part of it, we have to apply the partial derivative here, and it will be changed as shown here. We'll now apply this knowledge about the partial derivative of transformation matrices in our previous equation. And we see a lot of terms will vanish because the partial derivatives would be zero. And only one term is left, namely the term having a partial derivative of the J transformation matrix with respect to theta j. That means that our computation boils down to this equation that we are seeing here. And we now wish to see if we can do something clever about this partial derivative in order to further reduce our computations. Here we have written up the partial derivative of the jth transformation matrix with respect to theta j. If we look carefully at the result of this, we will notice that we can rewrite this into a product of two other matrices, namely the original transformation matrix, and then this strange looking 0, 1, minus 1 pattern matrix. If we look carefully at how this matrix transforms the transformation matrix, we will notice that the zero row and zero column would mask out the last row and last column in the transformation matrix. So we receive the zero pattern here as we want. And the upper two by two parts permute the rotation matrix part and make sure that the signs fit with the partial derivative that we want to have. We can now use this product in place of the partial derivative in our computation. This is shown here. Here we had the original computation with the partial derivative, and below we substitute in this strange looking permutation matrix multiplied by Tj. We will now use this result to reinterpretate what we are doing. Here we have the equation one more time. We will now read the equation from the back to the front and see what goes on. So the terms we see here take the tooltip vector into the link frame of the jth length. This means that this is essentially the difference between the origin of the jth length and the end effector position as seen from the jth link frame. Then we apply this operation here to that difference vector, and we notice that if we look carefully at this and go back from homogeneous coordinate to 2D coordinates, then this operation up here is essentially the hat operation. So in 2D Euclidean coordinate system, this matrix corresponds to taking the difference vector between the link origin position and the end effector position and taking the hat operation on that vector. Going back to homogeneous coordinates one more time, we see that this hatted difference vector is now converted into the world coordinate system. So a different way to approach this is to do the computation in the world coordinate system instead. That means we're going to find the link position of the jth link frame in the world coordinate system, and then we're going to find the end effector vector position world coordinate system. We're going to take the difference of those and apply the hat operation, and we will have the same computation as shown here. So here we see the idea: find the difference vector between end effector and the jth link frame position, and then apply the hat operation to that vector and fill this in the jth column of the partial derivative of the end effector. The only challenge we have left is to find a way to compute the origin of a jth link frame in the world coordinate system. We will now try to derive an approach for that. So we're going to introduce the symbol P for the origin of the link frame, and we will start out in the world coordinate system and simply define the origin here as 0, 0. And we're also gonna define a rotation angle equal to 0 degrees. Looking at the first link, we can find the link origin shown here as the green star by taking the link origin of the parent link, that is the world frame here, P minus one. And then we're gonna add the link vector, but we need to remember to rotate that vector with respect to the previous link frame. In order to keep track of the rotation angle, we're gonna use an auxiliary symbol called beta. So we're gonna define beta zero as the theta minus one here, and then we're gonna rotate the length vector of the zero length by this rotation matrix. This is a little bit artificial because we define theta minus one to be zero, but we keep this structure in order to show how this recursion will continue when we look at links further down the chain. Let's go to the second link. So this would have position P1. We find P1 by taking P0, and then we're gonna add in the link vector, but we need to make sure that the link vector is rotated such that we have the link vector in the world coordinate system. In order to find the rotation of the link vector with respect to the world coordinate system, we have to accumulate up all the rotations that have been occurring down through the chain. So that means we take beta zero and we add in theta zero. So that means we add in the rotation of this frame to the previous known rotations. And then we use this accumulated rotation to transform the link vector into a world coordinate system before adding it to the link position of the previous frame. We can do this repeatedly. So here we just show it for the last link, the third link. Again, we accumulate the rotation that have been occurring such that we know how our link frame is rotated with respect to world coordinate system. Then we're going to apply this rotation to the link vector in order to get the link vector with respect to world coordinate system. And then we're going to add the link orient to that in order to find the final position of the last link origin frame. One can actually also use this approach to find the end effect vector. So we can think of the tooltip vector as an imaginary link. We can just show this here. So here I just drawn the tooltip vector. So it could be seen as an extra link, and the recursion formula is applied in the same fashion. The only difference is that I'm going to use the tooltip vector here instead of the link vector. So by construction, we have shown that we can use these incremental rules to make forward sweep through the robot chain, one link at a time, computing the link frame origins. And of course, we need to store these later on in order to compute the Jacobian. So in summary, the final algorithm for computing the derivative of the end effect vector is that step one, we first have to compute the end effect vector and the link frame origins, the position of those. Step number two is simply just filling in the Jacobian column-wise using the information from step one.